So as part of Missions Month 2021, we are launching a practical mission tool of one of our mission partners, Farming God's Way, namely Gardens of Faithfulness. Essentially, Gardens of Faithfulness is a simple program that everyone at Harvest can participate in, whereby you cultivate a small 1x2 meter vegetable garden of your own at your own home and go through the process and principles of Farming God's Way. In doing so, you will not only reap the benefit enjoying a bunch of delicious and nutritious vegetables, but you will also learn the godly beauty and blessing of sowing and reaping, which you can then go on to teach others to play a part in growing God's kingdom in your family's life, plus everyone else who you'll share it with. This is a simple way in our busy day-to-day lives for us all to go on a mission together. And we would really love to see as many harvesters as possible getting involved in Gardens of Faithfulness. And what a better time than Missions Month, springtime. All you need to do is simply watch a short 45-minute video compilation and then get your garden starter kit from the church for just 30 rand. Although, you're welcome to source the compost and seedlings yourself. And then, please don't worry. You don't need green fingers. Anyone can do this. Just follow the steps and your faithfulness will be fruitful. And then once you are gardening together in our different locations, let's make every effort to share what we're doing around with others so that they can be inspired to join the mission too. What follows now are a few visionary as well as practical videos to get you started on this special mission. Thank you, enjoy, and please do not hesitate to contact us should you have any questions.
Welcome to the Model Farming God's Way Farm at Grassroof in Port Elizabeth in South Africa. My name is Grant Dryden and I've had the privilege of being able to extend Farming God's Way internationally for the past 17 years. South Africa is in a real crisis with a very weak economy that's been further weakened by the COVID-19 lockdowns. The official unemployment figures in South Africa are over 30% and it's only climbing. This is a very serious issue for the most marginalized of our people. And most sectors of society are cutting jobs. But there's only one sector that remains wide open, and that is agriculture. Throughout the years of extending Farming God's Way, we have seen astounding improvements in thousands of international cases where people have had their lives and their livelihoods transformed. For example, our lead Farming God's Way farmer, Dixon Shuali, he went from his father's 3 bags on an acre right up to 69 bags on the same piece of ground over a 4-year period. More importantly, we have seen an incredible transformation in both individual farmers' lives as well as in village communities, where we've seen the yoke of poverty loosened, removed, and even broken off their lives. However, in the past 17 years of extension, thousands of people have been trained in South Africa, and yet the adoption levels are very, very low. It's important to understand the reasons for this in order for us to be able to make the necessary adjustments to the strategy and to be able to bring about successful adoption and change lives and livelihoods. Firstly, the South African rural tribes were historically pastoralists. They were not agrarian by nature. They were looking after cattle and goats and sheep, and as a result of that, they don't have growing food as a natural part of their historical culture. Secondly, there's been a massive influx of people from the rural areas moving into the cities to try and find work, and this urbanized sector of society is currently the most at risk. Thirdly, there's been a severe dependency syndrome that has been developed amongst the poor because of government grants and handouts, which has really crippled the poor and their desire to work, as well as their ability or confidence to be able to create viable businesses. Fourthly, what we've noticed is that even though we see our model farm as something that's very large and the trainees love it, they can't relate to this or implement it because they don't have the size of land that's readily available, certainly not in the towns anyway. Fifthly, There are so many obstacles for the poor to be able to overcome to start a garden. They don't know what or how much or even where to buy the necessary inputs. And even if they want to, they end up buying seeds and seedlings at exorbitant prices, which makes growing vegetables unviable for them. So during this lockdown period in May, I was praying in this garden and I said to the Lord, Lord, imagine if we had 100 gardens like this one in South Africa. I stopped and I corrected myself and said, Lord, no, 1,000 gardens. And then I paused again and I said to myself in my heart, Lord, what about 1,000,000 gardens like this? And as I began to comprehend what that might look like, something settled in my heart. But I realized that it is not attainable on large scale and we need to make some adjustments. To set your mind at ease right now, I just want to tell you that we are not asking you for anything, except that you get actively involved. We can do this, and we must do this, but it must be done in a different way. The issue is not whether Farming God's Way works or not. It has been demonstrated and has a long-standing history of success across many nations, climates, and various crop types. The issue is how to get the poor to do this successfully. How do we break through all of the barriers that keep them from walking in the fullness of God's plan and His providence? To change from a pastoral to an agrarian culture, you first need to change the mindset to be able to believe that the land has been given by God so that we can profit from it. And to be able to do this, they must be successful in their very first attempts. The Bible says in Luke chapter 16, verse 10, he who is faithful in a little thing is also faithful in much. Being successful is a critical factor in this journey. And so we want the community to start small and be faithful with a little, that they may have success, which in turn will breed success. A senior man of God recently said to me the other day, he said, you know, the answer to the economic crisis in South Africa is that we must get the people to leave the urban sectors and go back to the land. I heartily agree, as it's the only viable remaining economic sector for the poor to be able to lean on. But they can't go back to the land and do what their forefathers did in the past, as they will soon be back in the towns, having failed to make a living out of the land. We have to learn from our mistakes. Farming God's Way is a completely different way, revealing God's blueprint from when He first planted the garden in the east of Eden. And He put Adam into the garden He had made and told him, work it and take care of it. Farming God's Way unlocks the potential of the land and shows us how to align our ways to His ways and walk in His favor and His blessings. Historically, many garden programs have started and then failed based on the major flaw that they too are perpetuating the dependency syndrome through handouts. However, as soon as the handouts stop, so do the garden programs. In the Gardens of Faithfulness programs, we are not going to give any handouts or hand ups or cash loans. We are going to teach people how to grow nutritious vegetables using their own hands by utilizing the natural resources that God has already provided, and they exist all around them. Trainees will have to clear their own garden, collect one shopping packet of manure, five shopping packets of grass or leaves for mulch, and one 500ml margarine tub of wood ash. The very small size of the Gardens of Faithfulness, 1 meter wide by 2 meters long, is critical for getting adoption and for the principles to take root in people's lives. They are made up of 2 rows of green beans, 2 rows of spinach, 1 row of beetroot, and 1 row of spring onion. This is a very simplistic version of Farming God's Way, which anyone can do whilst providing excellent daily household dietary supplements. Out of the 1 meter by 2 meter garden, many of the fullness of the skills in Farming God's Way can be gleaned over time as the trainees engage in repeat trainings throughout the growing season. Those that are faithful will in turn be rewarded with the opportunity to be able to expand their gardens next season. And over time, we trust that the confidence gleaned on small scale will birth the realization that their families' currently idle hands have the potential to become the sources of their own food security and viable farm businesses in the future. To bridge the pricing gap between the small grower and the large-scale seedling suppliers, we are working to be able to establish a beneficial pricing strategy for our most marginal communities in our nation. We want to be able to make seed and seedling packs available for sale between 10 Rand and 15 Rand. This cost is less than a packet of chips, and yet the value of the Garden of Faithfulness crops is approximately 500 Rands worth, and supply each household with year-round fresh produce. To reach 1 million people in this country and bring a measure of food security to each of these households is an enormous task indeed. But it is doable if we each work through our own existing areas of influence. This is a very exciting empowerment model and has the potential of drawing many parts of the body of Christ together to fulfill the challenge of Isaiah 58. To feed the hungry, to clothe the naked, and to shelter the homeless, and not to hide ourselves from our own flesh and blood. In a way, though, that equips the poor to be able to help themselves and bridge the seemingly impossible chasms that separate them from being able to break out from under the yoke of oppression. They say that it only takes a spark to light a flame. But if we have many sparks across this nation, we can see a wildfire of God's glorious hope revealed to those most in need. We look forward to walking alongside you and your organization's successful rollout of the Gardens of Faithfulness program. Welcome to the Model Farming God's Way Farm at Grassroof in Port Elizabeth, South Africa. Many people come to this beautiful Farming God's Way model and they're amazed at how beautiful and productive this garden is. But unfortunately, many are also turned away by the sheer size and the complexity of this garden. We want to be able to give you a hands-on opportunity to gain experience with vegetables so that you can get started and become successful. This 1x2 meter garden right here next to me is called the Garden of Faithfulness, and we want to see 1 million of these gardens planted throughout our nation. Luke chapter 16 verse 10 says this: "He who is faithful with very little is also faithful with much." See, being successful is a very important part of success, and we want to be able to ensure that you start small, be faithful with a little, and we want to see you grow in faithfulness and let God add to you. So Nomfundo Manzini is an accredited Farming God's Way trainer from Adutshwe in the Transkei, and she'll be coaching you through the Gardens of Faithfulness practical today.
Gardens of Faithfulness are 1 meter wide by 2 meter long and planted with easy to grow vegetables, with two rows of green beans, two rows of spinach, one row of beetroot, and one row of spring onion. This small garden can provide excellent household dietary supplements for your family during these very difficult times in our nation. Here is what you need to plant your garden of faithfulness. 13 pegs cut to 20 centimeter long. You can use plastic conduit or hardwood or steel or even small plastic bottles filled with sand for pegs. You need two measuring ropes, 1 meter long and the other 2 meter long, with loops tied into each end. Measuring stick, 37.5 centimeter long. Planting stick, rounded on the one end. A match box, a large book or piece of newspaper, a fork or a hammer and steel rod, a hoe or garden spade, a tablespoon, 500 mils of wood ash, 500 mils bowls or tins, 6 liters or 1 packet of fresh manure, 5 packets of dry leaves or grass, a watering can, or 6 2-liter bottles with holes burnt into them. 25 green bean seeds, 10 spinach seedlings, 10 beetroot seedlings, and 10 spring onion seedlings. Gardens of faithfulness are designed for flat ground, but if your garden is at risk from waterlogging or has insufficient soil depth, or it's too rocky or steep, or there are risks of physical damage, then use one of these permanent raised bed designs. You can use simple raised beds, or bricks, or wooden planks, or even boxes to establish a suitable growing environment for your garden. Clear the area by shallow weeding and pulling out any creeping grasses. Don't plow the soil. Just get a nice clean level surface to plant into. Pace out your 1 meter by 2 meter garden to get a feel of how it will fit in neatly at your home. Hammer in corner peg number one at the top left side of your garden. Attach the loop of your 1 meter rope and pull it tightly across the slope, and hammer in corner peg number two. This is called your baseline. Planting across the slope is very important, as we want to slow the water running down the slope to limit soil erosion to an absolute minimum. Place your book or large piece of paper up against the baseline at corner two. Attach the 2 meter rope and adjust it until it lines up with the edge of the paper, making a perfect square down the slope with a temporary peg. Place your 37.5 centimeter stick on corner number two against the downslope rope and hammer in peg for row number two. Repeat the 37.5 centimeter spacings for rows 3, 4, 5, and 6. Now move the 2 meter rope to the left side and use your book again to establish the square of corner number one. Again, place your 37.5 centimeter stick on corner one against the downslope rope and hammer in the peg for row number two. Repeat the 37.5 centimeter spacings for rows 3, 4, 5, and 6. You should end up with 6 neat rows, each 37.5 centimeter apart. Drive all your pegs in deeply, leaving only 5 centimeter exposed so they can't be moved by animals or children. They are there to establish a very important agricultural principle called permanence, which we will teach you more about in the upcoming repeat trainings. Vegetables have got very weak root systems, and so it is essential to loosen compacted soils to allow for successful production. Push the fork 30 centimeter deep and gently pull the handle backwards until you see the soil just loosen or fracture. Do not be tempted to lift or turn the soil. You should be merely fracturing it. Keep on repeating this every 10 centimeter, moving backwards across the row line. If you don't have access to a fork, then you could use a steel rod and hammer it in to 30 centimeter deep to break up compacted soils. Over time, the soil will be gradually redeemed through fracturing, organic inputs, and activity of insects and earthworms. Place a rope onto row number one's pegs. Lift and drop it several times to make sure it is taut and straight. Looking up the slope, begin digging the furrow a few centimeters away from the rope, gradually going deeper and deeper until you come right up to the rope. Dig the furrows 10 centimeters deep, keeping the soil in a neat heap on the downslope side of the furrow for refilling later. Repeat the 10 centimeter deep furrows for all six rows. Soil acidity is a very common problem in many soil types and climates, and the cause of all kinds of limitations to vegetable growth. Wood ash is a free resource and is effective at reducing soil acidity and also supplying your vegetables with macro and micronutrients. Evenly spread 2 tablespoons of wood ash per row. Use wood ash for at least the first 2 seasons. Thereafter, do trials in your garden to determine the visible benefits between rows with and without it. Vegetables need lots of nutrients in order to flourish. And the Bible teaches us that we need to sow in order to reap. If you sow bountifully, you will also reap bountifully. But if you sow sparingly, you will reap sparingly. If you give nothing, you will get nothing. Manure is freely available and a good source of organic nutrients for your vegetables. Evenly spread 2 500 ml bowls of manure in the bottom of each of the 6 rows. In readiness for planting, cover all 6 of the rows level with soil. Water in each of the covered furrows well before planting. This garden design has 3 portions, which is very important for the rotation plan. It is divided into fruit, leaf, and root portions, each with 2 rows. The vegetable crops we have selected are tasty and nutritious, easy to grow, not susceptible to pests and disease, do not require specialized nutrients, and produce a lot in a short period of time. The fruit portion, rows 1 and 2, are where we will plant green beans. In the leaf portion, rows 3 and 4, plant spinach. And the root portion, rows 5 and 6, plant beetroot and spring onion. Place your 1 meter measuring rope across row number 1. And press a 3 centimeter deep hole with your planting stick, 1 matchbox downslope of the rope. This is directly above the inputs you placed in the furrow. You can use your fist width as a fairly good measure for 10 centimeter spacing between the holes. Move the rope down to row number 2 and repeat pressing the 10 holes 10 centimeter apart and 3 centimeter deep. Place 1 seed in each of the holes. Then cover them, level again, and firm up gently. Keep the extra seeds to fill in any gaps if your beans do not all emerge after 10 days. Place your 1 meter measuring rope across row number 3. Press a 6 centimeter deep hole with your planting stick, 1 matchbox downslope of the rope. You can use 2 fist width as a good measure for the 20 centimeter spacing between the holes with 5 holes per row. Transplant the seedling into the 6 centimeter deep hole. Hold it at the correct depth and then press with your fingers into the soil at a 45 degree angle to gently close up any remaining airspaces. Plant 5 spinach seedlings across row number 3. Move the rope down to row 4. Press the 5 holes 6 cm deep and transplant the other 5 spinach seedlings in the same way. 3 things are very important when transplanting seedlings. Always plant into moist soil. Don't force seedlings into holes that are too shallow, as this causes J-rooting and stunted growth. Ensure that you gently close the airspaces around the root ball, or else you get significant root dieback and retarded growth. Place your 1 meter measuring rope across row number 5. Press 10 6 centimeter deep holes with your planting stick. 1 matchbox down slope of the rope with 10 centimeter spaces between the holes. Transplant the 10 beetroot seedlings across row number 5, carefully closing the airspaces around the root ball by gently firming up from the side. Place your 1 meter measuring rope across row number 6, just like you did with the beetroot. Press 10 6 centimeter deep holes with your planting stick. 1 matchbox downslope of the rope with 10 centimeter spaces between the holes. Transplant the 10 spring onion seedlings across row number 6, remembering to close the airspaces by carefully firming up from the side. God's blanket is a wonderful secret to success that God has shown us through His creation. In our vegetable gardens, we use dry leaves and grasses as blanket material. This will help to conserve moisture and greatly reduce weed growth in your garden, amongst many other benefits. In the follow-up training, you will learn a lot more about the benefits of God's blanket. Apply God's blanket onto the garden, 2.5 centimeter thick, spreading it evenly around the newly planted seedlings. But make sure you leave 5 centimeter wide gap on top of the bean rows to allow for germination. Once the beans are at about 10 centimeter tall, then the blanket can be brought right up against the plant bases. Water your garden lightly with a watering can each day for the first week, and thereafter more heavily 3 times a week, depending on rainfall. You can also water with old 2-liter bottles with 10 holes bent into their bases with a hot nail. Place two bottles in every second row. If you don't have water readily available, then use bath water. Harvest your beans regularly to ensure they keep producing new flowers and pods. Beans will be in the ground for up to 3 months, giving multiple harvests of delicious beans for up to 8 weeks. So look after them well. Harvest only the outer two leaves of your spinach plants by snapping them off with a sharp sideways jack. The inner leaves will continue to grow back and the plants will keep supplying you with fresh, healthy spinach leaves for the next 6 months. Start harvesting alternates of the beetroot roots at golf ball size so that when the last bits are harvested, they are not too big and woody. Beetroot is a fantastic plant as you can also harvest and eat its leaves to supplement your diet. But wait for 4 weeks until the plant is strong enough to handle this extra harvest. Beetroot should be in the garden for 2.5 to 3 months. Harvest every second spring onion plant from when they are 40 centimeters tall. Uproot the whole plant, trim off the roots, and chop up the leaves into soups and stews. Spring onion grow fast and will be harvested within 2 to 2.5 months, making them a much better option for small gardens as compared to onions, which take forever to grow. The beans, beetroot, and spring onion will be harvested before the 6-monthly seasonal rotation of fruit, leaf, and root portions. So there will be a second planting of the fruit and root portions with a rotation within a rotation here to keep your garden in a constant state of fruitfulness. Stay connected to your facilitator for updates or follow-up trainings and seed and seedling disbursement opportunities in your up and coming rotations. The repeat training sessions will take place every 3 to 4 weeks and enable you to grow in knowledge and skills to become an excellent Farming God's Way implementer.
This little garden may seem like such a small and meaningless garden to you, but the Bible teaches us in Zechariah chapter 4 verse 10, do not despise the day of small beginnings, for the Lord rejoices to see the work begin. I want to encourage you that as you begin your own garden of faithfulness, managing it on time to high standard with minimal wastage and with the fruit of the Spirit, that as you are faithful with a little, that God will add to you. Lord Jesus, we pray over this garden and all the gardens of faithfulness, wherever they are planted, that they would flourish and multiply greatly throughout the nation. I pray for those that are faithful, that you would more than abundantly provide for them and bless them and their families during the season of great difficulty. Lord, I pray that you would cause these precious people to grow from strength to strength in all areas of their lives and walk in your promised abundant life. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
In Genesis chapter 1, we read how God, our awesome and wondrous Creator, created everything in the heavens and on the earth. And He looked and He saw that it was good. He created the light from which all life derives its source. He created air, water, and nutrients and their complex cycles upon which all life is supported. He created the soil and all of its living organisms, both visible and invisible. He created plants bearing fruit and seed after their own kind. And He created animals. And finally, He created man. Everything He created was good and productive and fruitful. Nothing the Lord created was without purpose. And all of creation fitted together in a maze of complex interconnected relationships which are still trying to be fathomed by man to this day. An interesting part of the creation story is in Genesis chapter 2, when God made a food garden in the east of Eden for Adam and Eve. Genesis chapter 2, verse 8 says, "And the Lord God planted a garden toward the east in Eden, and there he placed the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground the Lord God caused to grow every tree that is pleasing to the sight and good for food, the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil." In verse 15, "Then the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to work and care for it." God created the very first garden and put Adam in that garden to work and care for it. God himself is the first and master farmer. In that garden, God taught Adam everything he needed to know about his creation, how to work the land and care for it. So, what is so important about this to growing vegetables? Well, quite frankly, everything. If we understand that God first created all forms of life and the structures on which life are founded, then we must acknowledge that He has a way of doing things that work in the best way possible. We all know that the very best person to teach you how to use something is its creator. The same applies in agriculture. We need to go back to the author of creation and observe the way He designed plants to grow within their created environment and be humble enough to learn from the master farmer. God's creation still demonstrates all of the attributes of God's garden in the east of Eden. He never inverts the soil. There is a continuous blanket or mulch on the top of the ground made up of many layers of gradually decomposing plant materials like leaves, branches, fruits, and manure on the surface of the ground, and a great biodiversity of species. All we need to do is follow the ways He has shown us since the beginning of all time. Within these demonstrated boundaries, we try to emulate as closely as possible what our Creator has shown us to do through minimal soil disturbance, keeping a 2.5 centimeter thick blanket cover on top of the ground, and practicing rotations. But this story is far more than just a technological practice. God designed for man to live in a real, tangible relationship with Himself, and would come to the garden to walk and talk with Adam in the cool of the day. Why would the Creator of the universe, the God of all, do that? Because He loves mankind, and His desire was to have a created being who would, according to His own free will, choose to have a heartfelt relationship with Him. No animal or any other earthly created being has this choice. When man sinned and ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, against the Lord's instruction, he broke that covenant of relationship. And as a result of that, Adam was kicked out of the garden. The land was cursed, and man was cursed with hard labor, sweat, and weed growth. None of these curses had been a part of a farming lifestyle prior to the fall. However, the worst thing that took place was that sin now separated mankind from God, and he no longer had this privilege of a divine relationship with Him, which was God's ultimate objective. The great news is that Jesus came to break every curse and to give to everyone that believes in Him the right to be called children of God, and once again to be reconciled to the Father in a real relationship. Colossians chapter 1, verse 13 says, "For He delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of His beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins." He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by Him all things were created, both in the heaven and on the earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things have been created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is also the head of the body, the church, and he is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he himself might come to have first place in everything. For it was the Father's good pleasure for all the fullness to dwell in him, and through him to reconcile all things to himself, having made peace through the blood of his cross. Through him, I say, whether things on earth or in things in the heavens. Jesus, who is called the second Adam, has made a way for us to have the ban lifted so that we can once again enter into the garden in the East of Eden and experience a life in relationship with our Creator. This is ultimately what we want to see happen in all of our Farming God's Way gardens, be that at field or small nutrition garden scale. Lives reconciled to a meaningful relationship with the Lord, and where His bountiful blessings overflow in the garden. This Farming God's Way vegetable resource advocates techniques that are proven and simple to allow for successful implementation amongst the poor. Farming God's Way is not just a technology, but a well-balanced biblical management and technological solution for the agricultural domain, equipping the poor to come out of poverty with what God has put in their hands and revealing the fullness of Jesus' promised abundant life. The Word of God is paramount to breakthrough in people's lives, and I exhort you to thoroughly work through the 6 Farming God's Way biblical keys as is found in the DVD series and the trainer's reference guide whilst teaching this material. John chapter 6, verse 27. Do not work for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man shall give to you. And in verse 35, Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall not hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. The management keys are just as important and include doing things on time, to high standards, with minimal wastage, and with the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Don't neglect these essential elements. The technological keys include no plowing, 100% cover with God's blanket, ensuring biodiversity through rotations, through relay and cover cropping. God's master plan was that mankind would live in a divine relationship with himself and follow in all of his ways. Through Farming God's Way, we are encouraging people not to follow a system, but rather a Father, Creator, and the Master Farmer. And what is really important is that we keep to the principles of doing what we see our Father doing.
I hope you enjoyed all the videos and that you are excited to get going with your own garden of faithfulness. Enjoy the time gardening outdoors and spending time with the Lord while you employ some beautiful biblical agricultural principles, and also experience and see the bounty and blessings overflowing from your efforts. I would like to encourage you to seek Gardens of Faithfulness forward by sharing the video link about Gardens of Faithfulness. We really do have the unique opportunity of not only learning ourselves, but also teaching others to nurture themselves. And of course, to establish relationships, disciple people along the way, and share the gospel. Think about it. If 1,000 harvesters can start a garden of faithfulness, and then if each one can teach one and reach one too, we really can make a big impact together for God's kingdom. If you need any more information about Gardens of Faithfulness or Farming God's Way, please do get in touch. We'd love to help. And if you need any assistance with discipling or leading others to Jesus, we're also here for you. On our website, you will also find an excellent tool in our new Believer's Handbook to help you in this regard. Happy gardening. Enjoy the special spring mission, and God bless you big time.